Good morning, Rose Hill. Good morning, Rose Hill. Come on, aren't you excited and glad to be in the house on today? Come on, aren't you glad that God woke you up this morning, that you were able to get up and come on in? Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that you're in your right mind this morning? Come on, aren't you glad that you have activity of your limbs? Come on, aren't you glad that God has kept you all week? Come on, aren't you glad that God has protected you all week? Come on, aren't you glad that God has kept you? Hallelujah. Come on, when the devil tried to come against you, oh my God, God said, no, you are defeated. This is my child. I shall protect. Hallelujah. Come on, we're just going to set this place, this atmosphere of praise and worship, and just give God all the adoration and love and worship that he is so worthy of. We're going to welcome his spirit into this place, into our hearts. Hallelujah. Come, we're going to lift our voice up as one choir, on one accord in this place. Hallelujah.
Welcome into this place. Welcome into this broken vessel. You desire to abide in the praises of your people. So we lift our heads as we lift our hearts, as we offer up this praise unto your name.
Come on, sing to God.
Sing welcome.
Into this place,
Lord, you are welcome,
welcome
into this
into
broken,
broken vessel.
For you desire
to abide
in the praise.
Worship him in this place.
Lord, you are welcome into
this place.
God, you are welcome into this broken
vessel.
For you desire to abide in the praise.
Yeah.
Let everyone please continue to stand as we offer up a praise of thanksgiving. Oh, thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. Oh, Father God, we come this morning, Lord God, just to say thank you, Lord God. Lord God, we enter into your courts with praise, into your gates with thanksgiving, Lord God. Lord God, we offer up this service to you, Lord God. Let your anointing flow, Lord God. Let your spirit flow in this place, Lord God. Let it touch each and every individual that's here, Lord God, that they would hear a word from you, Lord God. Lord God, we ask that you would touch the ones that had a desire to be here but could not be here, Lord God. Open up doors, Lord God. Close doors, Lord God. Lord God, we thank you for our pastor, Lord God. We thank you for the first lady. We thank you for the children. We thank you for every ministry at Rose Hill, Lord God. We thank you for the man of God that's going to bring the word today, Lord God. So, Lord God, we just welcome you into this service, Lord God. Into your gates, Lord God. Let your will be done in this day, Lord God, that as we walk in, Lord God, we will not leave the same, Lord God, that your spirit would reign on the inside of us, Lord God. Touch us, Lord God, from the top of our head to the sole of our feet, Lord God, that we would change, Lord God, and be everything that you have called us to be. So, Lord God, as you enter into this service, Lord God, we surrender unto you. We say, have your way, Lord God, in this place, Lord God. Let your anointing continue to flow, Lord God. Let your spirit continue to flow, Lord God. And I just give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise, Lord God. We give you back into the hands of the Rose Hill Ministry.
Hallelujah. Good morning, Rose Hill. What a mighty God we serve. It's a blessing to minister to you this morning. We're going to go a little older school today. Yeah. If you know that we serve a precious and mighty God, put your hands on it.
See? Hallelujah. Cause your tears are just temporary release. Your tears, it's just a release of the pain. Oh my. And your tears are expressions that can't be controlled. A little crying now, it's alright. Listen, cause after a while, you won't have to cry no more. Don't you worry, no.
Wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute.
listen, this is what you gotta do. You've got to hold on. 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 You and you and you and you and you and you and you. There in that spirit. Come on, let's give God some praise in this place. That's all right if that was for me. I would appreciate that. But I know that cannot be for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I mean, I know that cannot be for the great I Am. That can't be for Jehovah Jireh. That can't be for Jehovah Rapha. That can't be for the God Almighty. That's all right for me, but I need a few people to remember what God has done for them and to lose your mind. Come on, for about 10 seconds, let's press in. Come on, come on. Forget about your neighbor on your left and your right. Throw your hands up to heaven and rear your head back and give God a praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm glad to see you.
Glad to see you.
Now look at your other neighbor because you know they get real jealous. God, hallelujah. Boy, look at that spirit right there. It's here. He is here. He is here. Lord knows for the last couple of years, we've had a lot of tears. Lord knows for the last couple of seasons, we've been going through. But the key word of that statement is that we have come through. Oh, y'all not with me this morning. We've come through. That test, that trial was not our final destination. That test, that trial, that issue was not our headstone. God has breathed life into our bodies, and we are here today. One sound, one body, one family. Come on, somebody. We have come through. Come on, listen, let's just take a moment and give God thanks and give him appreciation for the man of God and the woman of God that he has placed over us. Gives one Pastor Danny M. Donaldson Sr., Lady Sharman Donaldson, the first family. We thank God for the gifts, amen. I don't know about you, but sitting under his tutelage,
I have certainly grown. And so if you have grown, come on, put your hands together. I'm pretty sure he's watching. So won't you make them blush while they're watching? Amen. Make them feel uncomfortable, even in their living room. Amen. Pastor, First Lady, we love you. First Family, Megan and DJ, we love you. Amen. How many know you sometimes you need rest? You need rest. You need rest. Guess what? Because if you don't break, you will break. Amen. What pastor? He's breaking. He's resting, right? And we all know when he comes back from these rests, oh my God, God has poured into him and given him another portion, another level to lead us out through the rest of this season. Amen. Come on, grab your Bibles. Grab your Bibles. Turn with me to Luke 17 and 11. Yes, grab your Bibles. Amen. I have an assignment today, and I do believe there is a word in the house that God is anxious to give us. His desire is to impart something into our hearts that I believe is going to encourage us, provoke us, challenge us to get through this season that we are in. Amen. How many know everybody's in different seasons right now? Your neighbor, they might be bawling out. Amen. But then you have a neighbor on the other side of you that may be going through. Amen. But the one thing that is constant for both, he's the God of both. In season and out of season. Amen. Come on, if you got it, shout to me. I got it. Amen. I dare not go a step further if I don't acknowledge my wife. Amen. My first lady, my queen. Like I say, the cream in my coffee. Amen. My three beautiful children. Hallelujah. My in-laws. Yeah, I thank God for them. Without them, I definitely would have maybe fallen off the path a long time ago. But it's wonderful how God has already preordained and created people to help you on your journey. And she is the best helpmate that a husband can ever ask for. Amen. Amen. And the Bible says, I'm going to actually start at the 17 through 19 verse just to set this up. Jesus said, were not there 10 healed? Where are the 9? Watch this. This is a very important question. Can none be found to come back and give glory to God except this outsider? Can none be found to come back and give glory to God? You may be seated in the presence of our life-changing God. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for all family for coming out in the threat of rain. You know what? Us folk, when they say we go rain, we like, we ain't going to church. I know that ain't y'all because y'all here. I'm just talking about them other folk. Don't tell them I talk about them. Come on, in this Lucan text, I'm sorry, which is pregnant with preaching possibilities, we catch up with Jesus on his way to Jerusalem. He is on the pathway to purpose. Yeshua is on his way to be crucified for no reason, but it is his love for us and his obedience to the Father that keeps his feet walking in the direction of the hill of the skulls called Calvary. Luke records an obscure detail about their location. Now, many of us would just gloss over it, but the importance leads to another piece of evidence of the character of Jesus. Stay with me. The text says Jesus was passing between Samaria and Galilee. Between Samaria and Galilee. My first question, the thing that I was curious about is, did this place even have a name? What was it called? And if Luke knew the name, why didn't he record it? Why would Jesus come to an unknown place? Watch this, don't miss it. Luke was very meticulous in letting us know that he was on the way to Jerusalem in between Samaria and Galilee. Everything that this cold-blooded Palestinian named Jesus did was calculated. He stopped in an unknown place to paint a picture of what his kingdom shall look like. See, Jesus is not just going to come for the known. Jesus is not going to just come for the affluent. But it's the unknown that has a place also in his kingdom. So if you feel voiceless this morning, if you feel like nobody knows your name this morning, the most important person that you need to know that knows your name is Jesus. Come on with me this morning. He stops at an unknown place. Watch this. I have a question for you guys, though. I have a question. What happens when you are in a place in your life that is unknown, unwanted, and you feel like an outcast? What do you do when you arrive at a place in your life where you're in between? That's a simple question, but it's provoking, and it happens to be the title of today's topic. Can you worship in between? Can you worship in between? The fact that Luke fails to mention the name of the village like most likely tells me that it contained other people whom Samaritans and Galileans deemed an outcast. Jesus is coming from preparing his disciples to what is to come on his way to purpose and arrives at pain in between. What do you do? What is the in-between? It is that place and space in the middle of where you are and where God is leading you. He's coming from having supper with the disciples, doing other miracles. He's wrapping up his tour. But then he arrives at an unknown, unwanted, outcast, isolated place to paint the picture that it is not these folks that are going to be forgotten, but I'm going to remember them as well. Watch this. There's a saying that emotions make great servants, but tyrannical masters. In other words, our emotions will lead us, will benefit us if we maintain them properly. However, if unchecked, they become a selfish ruler, bringing unnecessary frustration in our lives. Why did I go there? Why did I say that? We all sit in this room and we all have thought of a time. We can all think of a time where we say, man, we really overreacted with that one. We might have a little spat with our significant other or our spouse, and we go to bed mad. Come on. Y'all ain't going to say amen with me, huh? Some of y'all still mad at him. If so, just look straight. It's going to be all right. We all have had these, been bombarded with emotions, and if we let our emotions run amok, they will cause frequent and more turbulence in our life. But it's often through our emotions that we can obstruct or halt our relationship with Jesus. What do you mean? Our relationship with Jesus should not resemble the social media status of "it's complicated." Y'all know what I'm talking about. You see, you look at somebody's profile and it says married. It says single. Then every now and then it says it's complicated. What do you mean it's complicated? I mean, really, that means that that person doesn't have an indication of what type of relationship they're in. Are we together? Are we broken up? I'm about to get in somebody's business. Are we together but we open? Wait, like, look, I'm not judging you, but I'm selfish. I ain't sharing. We don't know what we are. We don't know what type of relationship we is. But guess what? That should not be the status when it comes to Jesus. If that is your position this morning, or posture, I should say, when it comes to Jesus, that means that there's a fracture in your foundation of your faith and trust in him. Some of you, God has promised you stuff, and it just hadn't come to pass. Some of you, you are experiencing what is called the growth gap, the space between levels of growth. But wherever you feel you are this morning, let me help you. Isaiah 55 and 11 says, so my word will be. So will my word be. Why did I say it again? Because I want you to catch this in the spirit. So this is Jesus talking, or God talking, God the Father, I should say. So will my word be, which goes out of my mouth and will not return to me empty. Okay, I'm going to do that again because I see only four of y'all caught that, right? Catch this. So God's talking, will my word be, which goes out of my mouth. So if God had promised you something, if you had heard words come from his mouth, if God has told you that he's going to do some things in your life, if God has said that this is going to happen for you, I don't care if it's not my word that I told you. It's not Big Mama word that she told you. It's not Pookie and Ray Ray word that they told you. It's important who speaks. If God says, I said it, it will not return unto me empty without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding in the purpose for which I sent it. God is not a man that he should lie, or son of man that he shall repent. If it's yea, it's yes. If it's no, it's no, it's no. Your faith in God should not be fractured because you're in a place of where your faith is in a holding pattern. You about to land? You about to land? Let me parenthetically pause and throw this out at you. Sometimes you're in a holding pattern because you're not yet ready for where the landing spot is. He knows that if you land right now, you're going to bust the wheels all up. He knows that if you land right now, the ground is not ready for your arrival. The soil is not ready for you to be planted. You cannot handle the weight that is about to be bestowed upon you. So I got to have you in a holding pattern for me to prepare you. But rest assured that God is not slack concerning his promises, for his time is not measured by our time, but he is faithful to fulfill it. God doesn't own a Timex. He don't have a watch. Amen. Come on, let's go further. Luke 17 and 12. I'm back in the text. And as he entered a village, 10 men with leprosy who stood at a distance, met him. It is customary for leopards, if you had leprosy, you could not be all upon folk. Leprosy was a deadly virus, which at that moment in time did not have any cure. So if you caught leprosy, you had to be literally removed from the community so that you would not spread, because you were deathly contagious. So they met him but stood at a distance. Let me comfort somebody this morning. The furthest you think you are away from God, that is the closest that God is really to you. The farthest you think that you are away from God, that is, I can prove it. Can I prove it to you? See, watch this. One of the symptoms of mistrust is that we lose what we call depth perception. What is depth perception? Depth perception is the ability to see and determine how far or close you are to something. Because all you see is pain and all you feel is isolation, you feel and you think you see that God is not near you. You are suffering from depth perception. But watch this. In 2 Corinthians 12 and 9, he says, Paul writes this, and he has said to me, this is after Paul had petitioned the Lord to remove the thorn in his side three times, right? And God says no. Wait, before I even move further, what happens when God says no? That's for somebody on that side. You've been praying, snotting, and crying. But then God's response was, I'm going to leave that alone. That's another message. And he said to me, my grace is, come on, Bible scholars, my grace is, for power is perfected in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I will rather boast about my weakness so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in distress, in persecutions, in difficulties on the behalf of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. So the farther you think that you are away from God, the weaker you believe that you are, God says, with me, you're the strongest. With me, my grace is sufficient to see you through. With me, you are able to carry the weight and the load that has been put upon you. My grace is sufficient. That's why every time God doesn't say yes. Why? Because he wants us to lean into his grace. Watch this. It's not the position that affected the lepers. It was their posture. It's not your geographical location. They could have stood afar against the mountain. It was their posture. It was their attitude of dependency on Christ that got his attention. Woo! I don't care where you are physically. I don't care what you think you are in your life. It's not your position, but it's your posture. Are you in a posture of total dependence? Or are you in a posture that lets God know, I got this? Guess what? God loves us so much that if we are in a posture of, I got this, he's going to let you have that. God's will, God's bill. My will, my wallet ain't big enough. Watch it. It's not your location that matters to an omnipresent Father, but it is our posture, or in other words, our attitude toward him that can affect our trust. Let's move to verse 13. You still with me? Y'all okay? Verse 13. Watch this. And they raised their voices saying, Jesus, Master. Boy, God loves when you call him things. He loves when you call him his traits. Master, have mercy on us. Guess what? The next thing I want you to see, family, is your voice matters. Your voice, it matters. Your voice, it matters. Don't you dare let your condition speak louder than you. Oh, boy. Don't you dare. Well, preacher, you sound like you're separating into I am. Because you are not your condition. You are not your issue. Your identity is not your sickness. Your issue, your identity is not your ailment. You belong to the Father. Your condition is only for a season. Don't allow your condition to speak louder than you. If you do, then when people look upon you, all they will see is your condition and not see the beautiful person you are. If you do, your condition will begin to hold conversations with folk rather than the child of God holding conversations with folk. All you will hear is, oh, woe is me. All you will hear is, oh, what I'm going through. All this hurts. All that hurts. I ain't got. This ain't enough. All this, all that. When God has called you to a place of abundance, God has called you his son and sons, joint heirs with Christ, royalty, a part of a royal priesthood, and you around here poor mouthing? Who talking? John says, I didn't make you to be serving me or serving the world. I made you to be standing up, being more than an overcomer. Watch this. I'm gonna prove it. Can I prove it to you? Watch this. Leprosy affects the vocal cords and breathing. Not only were they weak, but their voice wasn't strong. Revelations 12:11 says this. Here it is. I'm about to prove it to you. And they overcame. Right then and there, you were called the overcomer. And they overcame because the blood of the Lamb and by the what? Word of their testimony. How can a word come out unless you say something? Boy, y'all better come with me this morning. The word of their testimony. Well, I don't know what God, I don't think God has done nothing for me today. You alive, ain't you? You have cold breath and warm blood running through your body. Your breath might be not all that desirable in that mask, but it's still a breath. Amen. One thing I had to learn for these last 2 years, keep your breath, man, because behind that mask, I come on, hey, babe, ooh, wait a minute, ooh. Here you go. Dab me up. Dab, y'all stop playing in church. Look, listen. Leprosy affects the vocal cords. It affects the breathing. So not only were they weak, their voice wasn't strong. I want you to see this with your eye, with your spiritual eyes. Not only you had 10 lepers standing from afar, they're weak and feeble. Leprosy takes your breath, and it affects your vocal cords. I can see it. They can barely talk. But they got along amongst themselves and said, look, man, I can barely breathe. Then the other one says, man, look, my chest hurt. I can't even catch my breath. Then the other one says, but bro, this is our chance. If we all make some noise, we can get his attention. Let me parenthetically pause on that right there. You better make sure you got people on your team that's willing to use their voice when you ain't got none. You better make sure you got some people connected to you who are strong enough to strap you on their back and have a military mindset of no man left behind. We coming by here together. You better check your boarding pass and make sure everybody is on board. It's for you. Man, look, if we all make some noise, if we all shout, Master, have mercy on us, maybe we can amplify our voice loud enough so we can get the Savior's attention. Why? Because they understood that this was the only chance to get in the presence of the identity changer. This is the only chance to get in the presence of the condition healer. This is the only chance to get in the presence of the heart fixer and mind regulator. This was their only chance to change their posture and their position. Open your mouth. I don't care if you got to wake up every morning and talk to yourself in the mirror. You are of a royal priesthood. Today is going to be a good day. I don't care if the teacher called from the school. It's going to be all right. When I walk in my job, I am the bomb.com. If I'm single, somebody looking for me. Yes, it is. Yes, he is. I don't care what you have to do, but don't allow your condition or your issue to steal your voice. Watch it. And they overcame. Come here, David. I need you to tell the people what you did to bounce back. 2 Samuel 12:20. This is for somebody. So David got up from the ground, washed his face, anointed himself, and changed his clothes. He went into the house of the Lord and what? Worshiped. Can you worship in between? Can you get yourself off the ground? Can you wash your face? Can you anoint yourself? Put your smell good on. Put your perfume on. Put your weave in. Put your wig on. Throw it to the back, tie it up, whatever you got to do. Can you get yourself up? and get yourself in a posture of worship. When I refuse to look like what I've been through. I don't have to. He picked himself up. David says, enough is enough. If you don't know the story, I encourage you to go back and read it. He stepped outside the will of God. He transgressed. The baby died because of his transgression. He mourned. He would not eat. He became weak. His maidservants were trying to get him to eat. He refused because he was trying to get God to revive the baby. He was trying to get back in favor of God. So he was in a low, dark, isolated, unwanted, outcasted place. But one day he said, enough is enough. I'm going to get myself off the ground. I'm going to pick myself up. See, sometimes we rely too much on pastor. Let me call pastor. Wait a minute, who is your God? Pastor is pastor. Pastor's not God. David says, let me pick myself up off the ground. Let me wash my face. Anoint myself. I'm going to even change my clothes. I don't want to look like what I just came through. He went to the house of the Lord and worshiped. Preacher, how can you worship when the house is burning down around you? Easy. 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 Because when I remember who built the house, who made the ground, who created fire, when I remember that nothing can come nigh my dwelling unless God allow it. 1,000 may fall by my left, 10,000 by my right, but the noisome pestilence shall not come near me nor my dwelling. When I remember whose hand is in the hand of the master who calms the sea, when I remember who spoke to the climate and said, you better behave, when I remember who got himself up the grave and put on the new clothes and came back and showed himself to the disciples, when I remembered who parted the sea for Moses to walk across, fear not what man can do to the body, but fear the one that can destroy the soul. Why should I walk in fear? I have not given you the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. That's how I can stay and worship when the house around me is on fire and burning down. Listen, I'm almost finished. We okay? I'm almost done. I'm almost done. Acts 16:25. You don't have to turn there just for your listening. But I need to prove a point. I'm still building my case. 16:25 talks about the story of, you know it, very familiar, Paul and Silas being jailed. You know the story. You know it. Paul and Silas were struck, stripped, and shackled. Thrown in the inner prison. It wasn't enough. You know what? Let me just pause again. I have a lot of pauses because I'm kind of curious sometimes. You know, the spirit be talking. So listen, I was like, why did they throw Paul and Silas in an inner prison? Can somebody help me with that? It wasn't enough that they threw them in jail. It wasn't enough that they threw them in prison, but the Bible says they threw them in an inner prison. Wait a minute. DCI is medium security. Angola is what? Only real, real bad people go to well. Come on, y'all better come walk with me. If you did some heinous stuff, where you going? Angola. If you did some misdemeanor or whatever, you going where? DCI. So why would they put two men who were unarmed and posed no threat in an inner prison? It was something about them that they recognized they had some type of power. You tripping because the prison you in, you tripping because of what you've gone through, but maybe it's the power on the inside of you that the enemy is trying to crush, steal, and destroy. And you wonder, why, Lord, am I going through? Because they recognize the power. hate you. That's why they talk about you. That's why they plot on you, because they're trying to affect the power. They can't stand to be in your presence because of the anointing on your life. Woo! You ain't got to take your time and walk on the other side of the office not to be by somebody. Baby, if they don't like you, strut your stuff anyway, right by your desk. Good morning, team. And then keep on walking. Woo, woo. When boy, something cut you so deep this morning, when somebody say, God bless you, you boy, you might want to curse somebody out when you say that. God bless you. What you mean by God bless you? I mean God bless you. Look, baby, I know it ain't personal. I ain't did nothing to you. But I know it's something on me that you just, instead of fighting against me, you need to be asking where it came from. They say put him in the inner prison, y'all. They shackled him in the inner prison. Go back and read the story. Paul and Silas, they did something that they just could not fathom. Paul got irritated. I'm going to fill you in on the story. I'll tell you. I ain't going to leave you hanging. Paul and Silas was out. They had a girl who was possessed by a spirit. The Romans was using the girl as a fortune teller, making profit off the demonic possession. When the girl recognized the power of God upon Paul, she began to irritate him and agitate him. She began to say, there goes the people that serve God. Every day that he was there, she would walk behind them while he speak. Paul was like, leave us alone. She would kept going until Paul got a righteous indignation within himself, turned around and said, in the name of Jesus, come out. At that moment, the girl was released. She was no longer possessed. But the men who controlled her were mad, lied on them and said, they caused us to lose money. Ooh. What happens when somebody lie on you? So they got Paul and Silas. They stripped them. They beat them. And they threw them in the prison. That's the backstory. So obviously, they weren't armed. They weren't kicking everybody's tail with kung fu. So what about them that made them throw them in an inner prison? Watch it. No matter where Paul and Silas was thrown, that was just the eggs in the batter. Let me mix it up for you some more. It wasn't matter. It didn't matter what they were in prison or what they were in prison for. What mattered was they didn't allow their outward experience to affect their inward worship. No. They didn't let the fact that they were stripped, struck, and shackled to take their worship away from them. Watch this. Watch it. I believe, family, listen, hear me. I believe that the prison that Paul and Silas were jailed in is a metaphor for the prisons that you and I face every day. Yes. No matter where you are, we all have prisons. Some of us are imprisoned by our emotions. Some of us are imprisoned by our regrets, or in other words, our past performances. Some of us are imprisoned, watch this, by expectations. Not only by what expectations people have for you, but the expectations we have placed upon ourselves. Can I tell you a story? There was this CEO that was, well, first it was a CEO and a janitor that was both imprisoned by expectation. The CEO was imprisoned by the expectation for the performance of the company. He was trading personal wellness and desires for the success of the company. The unbalanced energy at the company was tearing up his marriage at home. The regrets of missing ball games and recitals were setting in. The emotions that came with the title had created a wall at that, so that now true transparency in communicating how he felt was null and void. Then there's a janitor cleaning up after people, resolving problems, trying to do their best to keep a maintained environment for others, not getting the appreciation nor acknowledgement deserved, regretting not taking advantage of opportunities early in life, feeling stuck. The CEO walks by the janitor. No words are passed, as if neither one existed in that place, in that space. The janitor looks at the CEO and wishes that he has what the CEO has. He sees the power that the CEO wields. He sees the vehicle that he drives. He assumes that his family must be happy and amazing. All the while, the CEO is looking at the janitor and envies the time he gets to go home with his family. I hope y'all hear me. See, he sees how well he maintains the property with excellent, making it look easy. Both were imprisoned. Both are shackled. One may look like they're doing better than the other, but both need Jesus to maintain their emotions while they're imprisoned. In Matthew 5 and 7, he implores us to cast our cares on him. In Matthew 11 and 29 and 30, he tells us to yoke up with him so that he can show us how to manage our emotions, forgive our past, and handle the expectations from others, including the ones that we place on ourselves. Two people in different stages of life, but both in prison. But there is a way to be imprisoned, maybe physically, or be imprisoned by condition, but walk freely as you were free. And the way is allowing Jesus to be yoked up with you to show you how to walk in on stuff that other people sink in, to show you how to teach you about how to manage our emotions, how to not let regret poison our future. We are all in prison, but Jesus is the way out. I'm closing. Verses 14 and 19. When he saw them, Jesus saw them. When Yeshua saw them, he said to them, "Go, show yourselves to the priest." That was customary for when you had leprosy. You could not return to the community unless a priest looked you over to make sure you didn't have it anymore. So Jesus told them, "Go, show yourselves to the priest." And as they were going, the Bible says they were cleansed. Watch this. Now one of them, when he saw that he had been healed, turned back, glorifying God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. He saw he was cleansed while going. Jesus didn't touch him. Jesus didn't spit in no mud and put on anybody. Jesus sent a word. Jesus said, "Go." He realized he was healed. My question is, what happened to the other nine? Ooh, catch it, family. 10 were healed. One came back to worship. 10 were set free from their prison. One came back to worship. Yeah. It wasn't that they were bad people. It wasn't that they were ungrateful, but it was they forgot God. They did forget Jesus. One thing, a solution to help you move your "it's complicated" to "I'm married" is simply one word. Oh God, one word. Remember. 1992, Michael Jackson wrote a hit. Remember the time. Yeah. Yep. Do you remember? Yeah. Fell in love. Oh, I, when we fell in love. Do you remember when you fell in love with Jesus? Do you remember the last time he got you out of the fire? Do you remember when he made the crooked path straight, cutting asunder the bars of iron, knocking down every high mountain that stood before you? Do you remember when you were crying that night and he came to you in your sleep and put a spirit of peace upon your soul? Do you remember when you were so sick you could barely keep your head up? The doctor gave up on you. Your nurse gave up on you. The prognosis and diagnosis said, why are you still living? How are you still breathing? You're supposed to be dead. But God's hand came in your midnight hour. His healing virtue absorbed you from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet and made you whole. Do you remember? Do you remember when you had nothing? Didn't know where your next meal came from. And someone brought you something. It might not have been what you wanted, but it was what you needed. It might not have been what you wanted, but it was what you needed. Just like Elijah was fed by a raven, a hungry, greedy bird came and gave him sustenance in the time of rest. Do you remember? Grandmama, do you remember when you was on your knees praying for that baby in the streets? Imploring God to bring my baby home at night? Mama, you remember when you was on your face praying for that daughter? Praying that he would soften her hard heart, protect your baby? I'll give you one more recent. You remember when COVID came out and you were thinking about your children? I know I hit my knees and cried a prayer that I can remember to this day. I feel chills. Even thinking about it, I said, God, protect my babies. Oh, God, oh, God. God, let me catch it to keep it from them. Protect my children. Do you remember? I remember what he told me. It wasn't audible, but there was a peace that surpassed all understanding that I felt in my heart. See, back in the day, you can read in Joshua 4. The children of Israel built altars of remembrance when God did something special for them. I feel God in this place. Every time God brought them to another juncture or he did something magnificent and great, they built altars of remembrance. Why? Not for just for show, so that the next generation can see and remember what God did for them. Not for just for show, so when the waters rose again and the enemies came again, they can look at the altar and say, well, wait a minute. If God did it before, he surely would do it again. He surely is capable of bringing me out again. He surely will come through again. If he held me before, if he snatched me out of death hands before, if he healed my body before, if he brought my baby home before, surely I built this altar to remember the goodness of God. I built this altar to remember the strong hand of God. If he did it before, he'll do it again, God. God, we worship you in this place. Come on, stand up on your feet. Oh, I feel it right there. Worship, 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 worship. Worship. No hand clap. Don't hand clap. That's good. But God needs to hear some words from your mouth this morning. Some of you haven't used your voice in a long time. Some of you haven't used your voice in a long time. Use your voice today. Come on, let me hear it. Come on. If you don't have anything to say, just tell God thank you. Come on, I don't hear nothing. I don't hear nothing. This is not the time to be bashful. Sometimes we have to be comfortable with the uncomfortable. But somebody needs a breakthrough this morning. Somebody needs to do what David did. You got up, yes. You put clothes on, but you got to finish the formula. Get to the house of the Lord and worship. Come on and worship him. Come on, worship. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, praise the Lord. Set the atmosphere. Come on, God. Worship people, worship. Worship people. Your baby came home. Your body was healed. That's it. That's it. I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you.
I love you.
Lord, I love you more than anything.
Come on, press in. Come on, press in. Press in. Don't get distracted. Press in. Press in. Press in. Somebody haven't told God that you love them in a long time. This is your opportunity. I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore you.
I worship and adore you.
Just want to tell you.
Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you
more than anything.
If you feel like today that you are farthest away from God that you've ever been, the Holy Spirit wants you to know that God is here. If you feel like you have been left behind, isolated, whatever the case may be, Jesus wants to let you know that I'm here. But the thing about Jesus is he's such a gentleman that he will not come in a place where he's not wanted. So this morning, if you are fighting a fight for your spiritual and physical life, I implore you to press in and let Jesus heal your mind, to bring peace to that storm, to rescue you out of the fire, to unlock the cages of your prison so you can go free. Oh, hallelujah. Love you more, 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 more than my life, God. More than my family, more than my career, more than my, more. God, we thank you for this moment in time. We thank you, God, for imploring and impregnating us with your word today. But Lord, we want to just pause for this moment and tell you that we love you more than anything. Lord, I ask that you would give your people a residue when they leave this place. Because Monday comes, Tuesday comes, and with each day, oh God, comes a new set of trials, a new set of giants. So God, I ask for a fresh anointing to fall upon your people today.
Yeah.
Oh God, I ask God that you would change the trajectory of their lives even now. In places where they leaked, it looked like it was death, that they see life. In places where there were darkness, that your glorious light would shine upon them, God. Touch now, Holy Spirit. Set the captives free. Open the doors of the jail, so they can be a living epistle and testimony of how you freed us, oh God. Lord, we love you. Yeshua, we love you more than anything. Have your way in our lives. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. And everybody agree with that prayer, shout it. Amen. Come on, let's give the Spirit of God. Come on, somebody. If the Holy Spirit has touched your soul, come on, give him a hand clap that not only confuses the enemy, but gives him the glory that's due him. While we're in that same spirit, there's three people we want to appeal to this morning. One, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the one who sacrificed himself for your sins, for you. If you don't know him, now is your opportunity to be introduced to a life-changing force of God. Yeah, if you allow him, he will change your life. If that's you, come on down. Don't be ashamed. Don't be embarrassed. For we are not a museum. We all have issues. And we all are here to get well. This is a hospital. And Jesus is the physician. Secondly, to that person, you may have backslid, went away from God for whatever reason. Doesn't matter. Just as a prodigal son came to himself and said, let me go home so I can at least be a servant. But guess what? He wasn't treated as a servant. He was received as a son. You are still a son. You are still a daughter. And your rightful place is in the kingdom of God. Come home. Lastly, for that person, you may have went from church to church, or you may have simply been seeking on your spiritual journey. You said, let me try this thing called God, called Jesus. Let me try. Well, guess what? This is your sign. Come on down. He's calling you. He's knocking at your heart. But the provoking question is, will you let him in? If that's you, I encourage you to come on down. We have ministers there. Come on, put your hands together for that brother. Y'all better clap like the Saints see this touchdown in this place. Don't y'all play with God. Come on, you better clap like Southern or LSU just scored. How dare you yell at the TV later on and not yell for him? All of heaven is rejoicing. All of the angels are throwing a party over one soul. Come on, somebody. Come on, he's not the only one. He's not the only one. There's another soul that belongs to the Master. See, you don't have to go 100% in the way. The beautiful thing about God is he will meet you right where you are. All he wants you to do is take a step of faith, a step of trust. A step that you will put your hand in his hand. Is that you this morning? This is not the time to be ashamed. The Spirit of the living God is wanting to insert life into you. Come on, family. You know how we do it. Do a roll check. Tell that person, look, I'll walk with you. I'll go with you. If you need special prayer, you need to make yourself down the altar as well. Yeah. The water is troubled. The water is troubled. His spirit is here. Will there be one more? My last appeal, because we don't want to tarry, but we dare not want to rush the Spirit. If you fit either one of those descriptions, I beg of you, come drink from the cup of the living water. Water that you shall no longer be thirsty. Come on, let's give this prince, this son of God, this heir, this joint heir, this overcomer, this conqueror. Come on, let's make him feel special. He's come home. On behalf of Pastor Daniel Donaldson, Senior First Lady Sharman, and all of us here at Rose Hill. Woo. Man, we love you, man. Look at me. Brother, we love you. Not only do we love you, but God loves you. Welcome home, brother. Come on, take him to the back and minister to our brother. Come on, let's give it up for him as he leaves. Come on. Hallelujah. Wow. What an amazing time in the Spirit today. We thank God for the word that he's imparted unto us. But guess what? Before we get out of here, it's giving time, Rose Hill. Yes, that's right. The Bible said that he loves a cheerful giver. Some translation said a hilarious giver. Why? Because we're putting God first. And when we put him first, the harvest is right. Amen. So if this is your Sunday to tithe, we don't go through all the hoops and we don't know. We are taught and we believe God that we are to bless him with our first fruit. So if this is your Sunday to tithe, please do so. You can text to give, which is very easy. You can lift your hands and some of our leaders will get an envelope to you. Or you can go onto our website, rosehillbanrouge.org, to give as well. Amen. For those of you that is not your Sunday to give, the Bible talks about a liberal soul shall be made fat. Ask the Holy Spirit what seed that you would like me to place into this ministry, to make sure that they're able to send the message forth flawlessly and in excellence as you see fit. Lights, air, buildings, they cost. Amen. Salvation is free, but our earthly venues are not. Amen. So it is through your generous contributions and you being obedient to God that Rose Hill is able to reach the masses and able to be the cornerstone of the community, which it is called to be. So don't ever think that your seed isn't flowing. Don't ever think that your money is being mishandled or dormant. For you can see the work that we're doing, and we all need to be partners with that. So if this is your time to give, or if you're giving a liberal seed, please do so at this time. Come on, praise team. Give them a little something. Come on, you can go ahead and stand on your feet if you're ready. We better get on out of here. Forgot. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this moment in time, this seed that we are planting into your ministry. We ask that you bring us forth a harvest that will blow our minds. We thank you, Lord God, for what you're going to do in and through us this week. It is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. If you have given your seat, you may be dismissed. But wait. There's still some giving, so don't walk too fast. I'm sorry. I see still some giving. Thank you guys for being obedient and patient.